Hi, I'm GF Jules, and I am going to show you how to make delicious gluten-free bread. I'll show you what this looks like here on my husband's iPad so you can see it. This recipe is at my website at gfjules.com. If you just type in artisan bread, you can see how to make this with the recipe, but I'm going to show you tonight as well how to make it. Now, I'm trying something different because we have been doing these Facebook Lives, and when the camera's flipped around, people are seeing things in reverse. So I don't want anyone to get upset and see things in reverse, so I'm going to try to follow along with using this so I can watch your questions as well. If you do have questions, please type them out and be patient, and I'll try to get to them. I would love to answer your questions because I want everyone to be able to make gluten-free bread as deliciously as possible. So we will, I'm gonna just pull this up here on the live, and that way I know who is asking me what questions. So hold on one sec, I'll be right back. Hi Patrick, good to see you. Let me find where this is. I swear, technology is not my friend sometimes. I can't find it on here at all, so I'm gonna have to flip it back over, y'all. I'm so sorry. I just wanna make sure that I see your questions. And so I'm sorry if you're gonna be watching me and you're gonna see things in reverse. Before I flip it over, I'll just tell you, everyone always wants to know what's the website, so we put it over here. It's gfjules.com. That's where you can get all of the recipes that you're gonna see today and any other recipe. I have over 400 recipes there on my website. And I also have tons of articles on gluten-free baking, gluten-free living. We're gonna talk a little bit tonight about gluten-free beer. All of that stuff is on my website. There's also the store on my website where you can get some of the baking tools that I like to use, as well as my number one rated GF Jules flour and baking mixes and some of the books that I've written as well. So it's really a great repository of information, gfjules.com. And what I'm gonna be using tonight is my sandwich bread mix. On the website, at the artisan bread recipe that I told you about, there is a recipe to make this from scratch. But one of the things that I encourage people to do is to make use of things like a mix that works so, so well, because it takes all the guesswork out of measuring and making sure you have exactly what I've used to make the picture look like it does. So I am just gonna dump my bread mix in. That's gonna be all the dry ingredients. And then I'm gonna add a few wet ingredients obviously to it as well. But that's what I'm gonna do. If you'd rather use the from scratch recipe, that is at gfjules.com. It calls for my flour as well as some other dry ingredients. The reason why I use my flour is because it is so very, very different from all of the other flour blends on the market. I created this in, I guess, early 2000s, maybe like 2004 or something like that. It was what I had done for myself to bring back baking for me so that I could make whatever I wanted to make. I was diagnosed with celiac disease back in the dark ages when there was no such thing as palatable gluten-free food, let's put it that way. So I had to create it all for myself. And this is the base recipe that I have been working with since then. And so many people really, really liked it that they asked me to manufacture it years ago. And ever since then, when I started manufacturing it, I have been tweaking it every year and going back and revisiting the mixes and things. And so I've made it better and better and better. And I absolutely love where we are right now with the mixes and with the flour. My son just walked in from work. Hi.
Hi.
I'm gonna have to flip this around because it doesn't work on your iPad. So I'm just gonna flip the little camera thingy around here in just a second.
See if it works.
Okay, well you can try it if you want to. Sorry. This is that witching hour when everyone comes home from school and work, and you know, we're just trying to throw things together. But I want to show you how easy this is to do even in the midst of all this chaos. So I will get started. I don't know if anyone's asked a question yet because I can't see anything. My husband's trying to help me. Anybody who has talked to Jeff before, that's Jeff. He was walking in the door from getting my son off carpool. So again, we're going to use my GF Jules sandwich bread mix, but this is going to be used to make an artisan loaf. The thing I love about the artisan loaf is it's just so beautiful when you're done. And every time I make one, they look different because it's artisan. It's just, it, you know, sort of evolves and rises and looks, you know, fun and different every time. It also looks different depending on what you put on top of it. I have different seeds and things like that that we can put on it, like sesame seeds, or sunflower seeds, whatever you want, or you could leave it plain. I also like to use a coarse sea salt because I just think it gives it a really nice flavor. The artisan bread that I'm gonna make tonight, I am going to add, for my liquid, I'm actually gonna use a gluten-free beer. You could use just seltzer water, you could use ginger ale, you could use any other type of bubbly liquid that you like, that obviously is gluten-free, or you could also use milk, or you could use yogurt. And those options are given on the website. They all produce a different type of bread, and that's fine. They're all different. Like the one with the yogurt is a denser, thicker type of bread, and it doesn't spread as much, but it's so yummy and moist inside. The one that I'm gonna make with beer obviously will have some flavor, and it's gonna have a different flavor depending on what kind of beer I use. So the one that I'm using now is one from Groundbreaker. I love these guys. They're out of out west in Portland, and they use only gluten-free ingredients to make their beers, because as you probably know, most beers are not safe for people with celiac disease or people who are gluten sensitive. So this one is a dark ale, so it's absolutely gonna taste different than another one that I would make, say, just with seltzer water. So it depends on what you like. And if you happen to have something in your house that, you know, an ale or something like that that you don't like, it would probably taste really good in a bread. This one I really like to drink it too. And there's gonna be leftovers, so that's the other bonus, is I get to finish this. Because that gets, you know, the bakers get to do that, right? So I'm going to, should I flip it around so I can see? No, I guess not. I mean, it's not, if there's a question, then that's what I'm
gonna hold on.
Okay. All right, Jeff's gonna help you with questions in just a second. So if you have asked a question and I haven't seen it because I have the camera flipped, wait a second, and then when he pulls it up on his, you can ask it again, and I'll make sure to answer it. So, sorry, please be patient. I know people were frustrated because things were written backwards, but now I can't see what the questions are. So, it's one way or the other. I don't know. I'm not sure. Anyway, all right, so basically what we're going to do is just take a bowl, and again, if you have a mixer, obviously, you can use your mixer. I like using a stand mixer because it gets things nice and mixed up really, really well without any, you know, labor. But when I'm using something thin, like a beer or a seltzer water, it's really going to be like a batter. It's not going to be a thick dough that's going to be super hard to manipulate. So it's not that hard to mix it up. And I've made things plenty of times this way, the old-fashioned way. I make pizza this way sometimes too. So don't worry if you don't have a mixer. I don't recommend using a hand mixer for these types of things because the dough can get kind of knotted around the beaters. And so you want to, you know, have a stand mixer with a paddle, or to, you know, obviously just use the a bowl and a spoon. We want to add our liquids mostly first. And the only liquids I'm using are 2 eggs, which if you can't do eggs, it's very, very easy to just do a flaxseed meal and water substitute. I do that all the time, especially when I'm doing cooking demonstrations, because I want everyone to get to taste it. So I'll just do a flaxseed meal and water substitute. If you go to gfjules.com and you type in vegan egg or egg substitutes or anything like that, I have a whole article on which egg substitutes I like for which type of application. So what I recommend for yeast applications and breads and pizzas and things is not the same thing that I recommend for cookies, for example. But the flaxseed meal and water works great with this bread recipe, and so there's no worries. And by the way, if you can't do yeast, that's okay too, because I have the yeast in here is in a separate packet. You just don't add that. And then you go and follow along the directions of my yeast-free bread. You follow the directions there where you add some additional chemical leaveners, the baking soda and baking powder, and follow those directions and then make your artisan loaf that way, or of course make your sandwich bread that way. So I'm just going to go ahead and mix in my eggs and stir them up separately. I actually am going to do it in here just in case I get any of the shells. When I have, I'm baking yeast, I always want everything to be room temperature or so. And so when I'm in a hurry, I'll just fill a bowl with warm water and put the eggs in the warm water, and it brings the eggs to room temperature really quickly. So that's my little trick for that. I don't know if anybody else does that trick or not, but I really find that it works well. So these are warm, and they've only been in the bowl for a few minutes in that warm water. So I'm just stirring this up to make sure that the egg whites and the egg yolks are integrated. And then I'm gonna add the other two separate liquids that I have, which are just oil and either honey or agave or coconut nectar, anything like that you want to add. So I just put my eggs in here, and then I have 4 tablespoons or 1/4 cup of olive oil. I actually really like olive oil in my breads. It tends to work really well, and it doesn't have a funny flavor or anything like that. Although, do smell your olive oil, because if you've had olive oil sitting for a while in your cabinet and you smell it and it smells kind of funky, that smell will transfer to whatever you're baking. So I would just recommend throwing it out and starting over again with some fresh oil. It shouldn't have a funky smell to it at all. Sometimes we get people writing in saying, you know, my whatever smelled funny. Well, this doesn't have a smell, so it had to be something that you added to it, and oftentimes it is like something that's gone rancid. So 1/4 cup of oil and 2 tablespoons of, I'm using some agave here, but you could use honey, or like I said, you could use coconut nectar or another liquid sweetener. The thing about this, and you could leave this out, but then you'd need to add 2 tablespoons of another liquid. I really like adding honey or agave because it has humectant properties, which means that it will help retain the moisture in the bread. And so, you know, several days later, this bread's still gonna be super yummy. So you don't have to worry about, oh, it's only good fresh out of the oven. It's not, it's actually good for several days.
Yeah,
no, but you can read the questions for me, right? All right, so if you have questions, Jeff is up now, and he can see the questions and let me know, and I can answer them for you real time. So stop me in the middle of what I'm doing if you have a question or don't know how I'm doing something. I'm happy to go back over that. All right, so again, all I have in my bowl right now is the 2 eggs that I've mixed that are room temperature, the 4 tablespoons of olive oil, and the 2 tablespoons of agave nectar, or you could use honey. Now I'm going to add my dry ingredients, and then I'm gonna put the beer or whatever other liquid that you'd want, I'm gonna put that on top. It just makes it a little bit easier to mix it. If I was using a bread machine, because this does work fantastically in a bread machine, I would put all of the liquids in first. That's just a rule with all bread machines. All the liquids go in first, and then the dry ingredients. So I'm just doing it a little bit differently to make it easier on me to integrate it in the bowl. Like I said, everything is in here that you need. You don't have to add any dry ingredients to it at all. So I'm just gonna dump that in. If you are interested in bread machine tips or what bread machines I recommend, just simply go to gfjules.com and type in bread machine. I have a huge article on there about bread machines and gluten-free, how to bake with them, which ones are the best, and how to program one if you have one that doesn't have a gluten-free setting. And then I also have another article where I compared and reviewed some bread machines that I really like. So I do travel and do cooking demonstrations a lot where I use bread machines, so I've used a lot of them, and I do have an opinion about some that are better than others. All right, so I've got everything in here except for my liquid, and like I said, I'm gonna use this groundbreaker because I think the smell for me of beer bread baking comes, I don't know, there's like a wonderful memory or something that I have from that I just really, really love. So I love the smell of beer bread. I don't usually use it when I'm baking for a crowd, like for a cooking demonstration, because then people taste something in the bread and they say, what's that taste? And they may like it or they may not like it, but the taste is the beer, not the bread. And I want people to taste how clean the bread mix tastes on its own. So the only thing about using a beer, as you can see, this groundbreaker's got this really great head on it. So it's nice for drinking, but I need to make sure that the measurement is accurate. I don't want to be measuring beer plus head equals 1 1/4 cups. I need the beer itself to measure to 1 1/4 cups. So I have just a little bit left to add. And already you can just smell, this beer smells so good. The other thing I was going to tell you about gluten-free beers, I have a huge article, I've got several actually on my website about naturally gluten-free beers versus gluten-reduced beers. Please check that out if you're looking for answers as to what's a safe beer for you. And I also have a huge post on beer tasting notes where I've reviewed a whole bunch of different naturally gluten-free beers. So maybe you could find one in there that you like, oh, that sounds like one that I would like, and then you can look for that or have someone try to carry it for you in a beer store near you. There are lots of great options now, like the Groundbreaker. So don't deprive yourself if you like beer. And even if you don't like beer, I think it makes a great baking ingredient. So, just throw that out there. All right, so I'm just gonna stir. I'm pouring this in now just so that I'm pouring it around. And I'm gonna get my wooden spoon. I also have a rubber spatula here just in case I need to scrape the side of the bowl a little bit. I have the rubber spatula and I can do that. So I'm just slowly gonna stir this. And like I said, when I'm done, this is gonna remind you a little bit of a batter more than a dough, and that's fine. That's the way it's supposed to be. And if you use yogurt instead, it would be thicker. But we're gonna do this because I think it makes a great bread, and it's also easier to stir. So I might start breaking a sweat or something if I had that yogurt, and I don't feel like doing that right now. It's making this gorgeous color too, just because of the beer that I added. If I didn't add the beer, it would be a lighter color bread, because of the flour that's in it is just completely white. But then I also add a few other whole grains into the sandwich bread mix because I just think, you know, why not? It's bread, right? You don't need a whole grain in your cookie, but might as well have a little bit in your bread. So I'm just mixing that up, and I'm actually almost done. You don't have to do much. And it's not like you've got to go kneading this or anything, because you don't want to knead gluten-free bread. You don't want to punch it down. You don't want to do all the extra rising and all that kind of stuff. And there are articles on my website about why that is. I'm happy to answer questions if you have any about that. But I want you to see this is what it looks like. And I hope you can see it in the video right now. It is this lovely color from the beer. And it's, you know, kind of thinnish because the beer does not have a lot of body to it. A milk or yogurt would be a thicker batter. But we are done with that. And now I'm just gonna take a piece of parchment paper. I like to spray it. This is just olive oil. This is Winona Pure olive oil. I like their sprayers, but anyway, olive oil. And then I just have my parchment paper. And I'm actually gonna use, this is just a springform pan because I find that it's easier to get the bread out of it. I'm only using this for rising, and that's because, as you saw, this is a wetter type of dough. So this will help to hold the dough together while it's rising. And then I'm gonna take this off. So I'll tell you a little bit more about how I do that in a minute, but I'm just gonna scrape the dough into the pan. Left over, and I want to make sure I get all this good stuff in the pan, so I'm going to use my rubber spatula. But let's see, move that over here, and I'm just going to get the rest of the dough out of the pan. Alright, scrape it off here. Now, if it's kind of rough around the edges, it doesn't look smooth or pretty, all you have to do is wet your spatula or your fingers and smooth it out if you want to. As you can see, it's nice and round in this pan, which is good because it's going to give it the shape that I want for when it rises. You saw the picture from the recipe. When it comes out, it's going to be this rounded loaf, so I want it to be in that shape. But that being said, because this is an artisan loaf, you can do whatever you want. You could do it in a square pan. You could do it, you know, in a long pan, kind of whatever you want to do. It's your bread, so you can do it the way you want to make it. So here it is, just, you know, in the pan, just like that. And what I'm going to do is let it rise. I have my oven going to 200 right now, and I'm going to turn the oven off, and I'm going to stick this in there and let it rise for at least 30 minutes. 30 minutes to an hour is kind of a sweet spot for a gluten-free bread. The yeast, that, oh, you know what? Darn it all. I forgot to add the yeast. This is the easy part because I can just throw it back in the pan. The yeast that's in here is an instant yeast, so it doesn't take a whole lot of time to mix it up, to let it rise. It's so funny. I do this not infrequently, and I actually have people tell me that they do this too. You're not going to just leave it on the top. You're going to actually mix it in, but the easy part is I can just take it right out of here because I oiled my paper. Yes, we all make mistakes, but this is a super easy one to fix because I just dump it back in the pan and stir it. The yeast is, like I said, instant yeast, so all you have to do is let it rise one time, and you don't have to let it rise for long. The yeast packet comes in the bread mix, so that's easy. All right, I'm gonna spray it again, just in case I screwed something else up, but I'm telling you, this is so tolerant that it's not gonna matter that I did that. It's pretty amazing, actually. All right, here we go, second time's a charm. I'm glad I started talking about yeast, because then I totally would have blanked on adding it. But that's okay. What did my other suspicion? All right, one more time. In case you didn't see it the first time, I'm scraping everything out into my pan. And because I hadn't added the yeast yet, it's not like I did anything to the mix by stirring it again. I wasn't like taking any of the air out of it or anything like that. That's part of the reason why you don't want to mess around with gluten-free breads once the yeast is added, because you really only get one rise out of the yeast, and so if you start punching it down or anything like that, it's not going to come back, and you don't want to ruin your bread that way. All right, so one more time, spreading it in a circle, la la la, and now all I'm going to do is put some cuts in the top of it, which will help it. Sorry, I know that's really loud. Will help it to have more shape. It'll help it to when it rises, to kind of rise in a prettier shape. So it'll have a natural break in the bread. If you remember the picture that I had of it, it had these three cuts in it, and it sort of opened up around those cuts. So instead of, if you don't do it, it's gonna rise and it's gonna crack, just like a bread would when it rises, but it might crack in a way that's not as pretty. Not a big deal, but that's just gonna be the way it is. So there are all kinds of fancy tools that you could use to put those cuts in the bread, but you don't need them. All I do is take, actually this knife's probably a little bit too big. I just take a regular knife, I'll get a smaller one, and I wet it so that it won't stick, because you saw what happened there. You don't want it to stick. And then I basically just put it in the bread like that, and I rock it back and forth a little bit. So one, two, three. And that'll give it like natural rifts to break, and it'll just be a little bit prettier that way. All right, and then if you want to put anything on top of it, this would be a good time to do that. You can spray it with more water. This is just water in a spray bottle, and that'll help things stick to it. I think poppy seeds and sesame seeds and things are pretty on top, but if you have an allergy or if you don't like those things, then leave them off. You could use herbs, you know, de Provence. You could use the salt. You could use fresh herbs. Whatever you like, it's your bread, remember? So you make it the way you want to. And this would just be if I wanted some fresh herbs, I'm gonna put a little bit of salt on top, like coarse sea salt. And it's already pretty, if you can see that. Basically, this is what it's gonna look like when it comes out, and it's gonna be bigger and darker and fluffier. And It's gonna smell amazing. So what I'm gonna do now is stick it in my oven, turn off the oven that I had warming to 200. I'm gonna cover it with a tea towel or a piece of oiled parchment. A lot of times what I'll do is I'll get like a tea towel like this and I'll get it wet and I'll just drape it over the top. The moisture helps the bread to encourage it to rise because of the yeast. The yeast wants moisture and it wants warmth. So if you get the nice warm environment, you've added the liquid to it already, and then you're going to be giving it some more liquid in the form of the tea towel being wet and damp, then it encourages the yeast to grow. Once it has done that, and you'll see pictures online too, once it's done that, after about 30 minutes to an hour, then what I'm gonna do, and this is where it's gonna be different depending on what kind of pan you use. What I did here, obviously, is used one that has the side on it where I can open it up. I can do that, or I could just lift the parchment up out of the pan, and then I take this pan away, and I just put the parchment on this pan. So it would be just baking straight away on a pan. If you don't have this kind of pan, don't worry. You could rise this in a bowl. You could rise it in your brownie pan, like whatever you wanted to. This just gives it a little bit of structure while it's rising. And then when you take it out, it will expand and it'll flatten a little bit and then it'll get a little bit of a crown in the middle. If you use yogurt, like I said, it doesn't really need the help of this pan very much. You could still use it, but you wouldn't have to. And it's gonna stay in more of a mound shape, but it won't expand as much. This is gonna, kind of expand the way yeast would want to. So that's it. I mean, basically, I'm just gonna go stick it in the oven to rise for a little while, preheat the oven after this is risen, and bake it for another like 35 minutes. I have the rest of this I could enjoy while I'm waiting, if you're into that. And then I have this lovely loaf of bread. And when you slice it, it's got this crunchy, yummy crust on the outside that you can use to dip in hummuses or things like that, or you could serve it on your Thanksgiving table as another bread. It's just a beautiful presentation, and it's a lovely loaf of bread on the inside too. One last thing, if you do want it to be super crunchy on the outside, you can put a piece of another pan in there with some water on it, or you could, some people do this, they'll like pour water on the heating element a little bit, just a little for steam. Or this is my trick, I just do more of this. So when it comes out of the pan from rising and the whole bread is exposed, then I spray the whole thing on the parchment. And periodically I'll open the door and just spitz it again. And what that does is that it gives the moisture to the outside of the loaf only, and it crisps up and the inside stays really nice and moist. So I'm not sure if anyone had any questions or not. Jeff, were there any questions that I need to answer before we cut it off and let people go about their merry way, hopefully to go bake some bread? But were there any questions that I needed to answer? Jeff? Anyone? Okay, I'm not sure because I can't hear him. He's in another room far, far away. But anyway, if you do have questions, you can post them in the comments. I will go back through, like I did in the last couple days of Facebook Lives. I will go back and answer all of your questions that way. gfJules.com has the recipe for artisan bread and has tons of other recipes, has products and articles like I talked about. So thank you for joining me. What? What? Okay. I don't know what he's saying, but thank you for joining me, and I hope that you all have a wonderful night and a wonderful Thanksgiving and happy baking.